Welcome back to Cheche, the program where opinion counts. Professor James Olekiyapi is explaining how he would run the country if we gave him the privilege of becoming the fourth president of the country. Now, you talk about economic and social empowerment, ensuring that every Kenyan has access to the basics, food, shelter, education. How, for instance, would you deal with the nurses' strike that's been ongoing?
First of all, that you're talking about healthcare. And what I want to do in healthcare, I would do three, four things. Number one, right now we have a major problem in terms of health system as such. In health system, I mean infrastructure and staff and management and supplies. That whole thing constitutes health system. And right now, the biggest challenge in Kenya is that the nurses are not enough and they are not well paid. I think this salaries and remuneration commission, what they are doing now, they have started from the top. I want them to go all the way down so that these salaries are bridged, because there's actually a lot of disparity. There are some people doing almost the same job or even much more challenging job, and they're earning much, much less, like teachers and nurses. So it's not a question of what you just do the nurses alone. If you harmonize the wage package in the public service, that should create a sense of equity. Let's say for all workers generally, we need to look at that. But we need also to empower them in terms of facilities, equipment, and staff that they need. You know, the gloves, the nurses need these things. And I saw this when I was a PS. We need to make sure that we have expanded the infrastructure in the health sector from the primary level, from community level to referral facilities. And I have committed personally that if elected president, every county will have one well-developed, well-equipped, well-staffed referral facility. It will cost about ₸1 billion. So that if you're talking about 47 counties in 5 years, you can surely afford ₸47 billion. Even if you just put ₹5 billion per year and you move on and you can cover all of them. The reason it is important is that then you stop thinking that everybody in Western Kenya has to go to Moi Referral or everybody else, east of Nakuru has to go to Kenyatta Hospital. Because public hospitals and or facilities are really not functioning.
You talk about the wage bill then. So what do you think of the proposed salaries for people ranging from the president down to the MPs that was published yesterday by the Salaries and Remuneration Commission?
It's a step in the right direction. Mm-hmm. It's very reasonable. I didn't think they went far enough, because they're still fairly high. Because if you come and look at now the rest of the people.
Say the nurses, the real workers. Striking, yes.
You can see the disparity is still huge. Mm-hmm. And I think in the end, once they try to
rationalize... What do you think would have been more reasonable?
No, I think the salaries in the range of $1 million and below would be reasonable. And there are still too many people over $1 million. But then because there are few, perhaps you could justify. But in the end, I do think that we must continue to bring the ones who are way up down and try to bring the lowly paid people up a little bit.
But in the private sector, salaries, if you are president, you get $1 million, and the chief executive, you get 2.5 of a company. You know,
but the president doesn't get $2 million. He gets, the president doesn't even use his
what,
money.
What do you think a President Kiyiapi then should earn as his salary?
Even what they have proposed is okay. But
in my view,
it should just be roughly around $1,800,000 there. Because if you put allowances plus everything,
it will come to
impossible amount. You know, I mean, how much do you really think the president
gets?
So
you could actually forego your salary and live off your allowances?
Yes, totally.
Okay.
Totally.
And you would do that if you were president?
I would do that. I have done this before. I have lived on a very small salary. I've been a PS of the largest ministries in this country, and my salary was, because I came from outside, I was just given, my first salary was about 300,000, and I was a PS. There were others who were earning almost $1 million.
Let me ask you, Prof, you say this whole thing about people earning less money. What is the rationale?
For what?
For cutting down the salary. You say people should earn like 500,000, you know, the highest salary should be about $1 million. When the private sector is paying people much more than that, what would be the inspiration, motivation to go to public service? Why don't we say we need to make the money the economy needs to generate the resources, whether through taxation or whatever, to enhance the salaries of the public service so that people in the private sector can actually, I mean, the public sector can compare with the private sector in their earnings, rather than try to whittle down what the public, who will go to work there.
No, that's not true. People go there, even people in the private sector who have earned enough money, who have enough money, people go to public sector not because they're looking for money. They go there because of something else.
What is it? To steal?
No. Yeah. Not just necessarily steal. Yeah. Some people go there because, maybe, but some go there because they have already earned enough. They just want to now serve, or they want to do something different. Some even just for something different. But you are right.
I would be hard-pressed to get a reason why people get into public service.
But let me tell you
that
this.
That is all, you know.
Again, you're asking a person who has been in public service.
Yes.
And I told you I used to earn 300,000. That was my basic salary, and it went up slowly. By the time I was coming out, I think it was about 500,000 for 6 years. Now, I could have just stayed outside and done consultancy, and actually I used to do that, and I used to earn a lot more. But sometimes you look at the, you know, security and that nice car, and you're taken care of, you know, and you look at the whole package and say, it's okay, I can live with this. Plus, the satisfaction that you're serving. There are people who go there because they actually want to serve. But there was the earlier point you are raising. Could we not raise, you know, package
the economy.
Raise the economy and pay people well. That's true. I think we should do that. But before you do that, before you expand the economy, you know, be fair. You cannot allow a few people to earn 2 million and others earning 10,000 shillings, and because that's all the economy can afford at that point. So I think you bake a bigger cake, then everybody can have more. But before you do that, rationalize what you are now paying.
So, of course, this is in the context of economic and social empowerment. How then do you ensure that every Kenyan has access to food, shelter, healthcare, education? How are you growing the economy to ensure that all of this is taken care of?
The economy in Kenya is already, let me tell you something. Kenya is is already one of the best performing economies in the region.
There's plenty within our borders.
There's plenty within our borders. We have natural resources that are not well managed. We have even oil and gas that we have just discovered. We have minerals which we have hardly exploited. We have tourism that is performing at I think 30%. If we can organize ourselves better, number one, create an enabling environment in terms of investors so that people come to Kenya and there will be no kitu kidogo. They can come and they find a facilitation by the government that they can come in and put their money there. Number two, make sure there is security so that people can put their investment of time. Number three, make sure these resources are properly managed, including money from the treasury, that we manage the resources and eliminate this pilferage and corruption that has been hurting us. If you do all this, and then finally align the human resource, because it is not well aligned. The biggest wealth of a country is the people. Right now we have millions of young people, about 6 million unemployed youth. They are not a problem, they are actually an opportunity. But we've got to create opportunities for them across the sectors, in agriculture, in tourism, in environment, in ICT sector. You have to build all of this. It's not a one silver bullet. It's a range of things that we have to do.
How do you deal with corruption in your government? How do you... NAC came saying zero tolerance. You have been in NAC government. And
I agree with you.
In your ministry, there was some real corruption when you were not there.
You'll probably not still believe me also if I say, but for me, it is, you can stop it, and it has to begin from the top. Corruption is not really the small people stealing little things, even though that also adds. But if today, as a president, I said, and I told my ministers and everybody around me that, please dare not move there, beginning with me, if you stop it at the top and completely crack the whip, if you fire one minister and lock them in, you'll stop corruption in Kenya.
Let's say,
how do they do in other places?
Yes, but
there's a rule of law, but the problem is that we are very...
You've been in this government.
Yes.
So we must also, judge you by your past.
Yes, exactly.
Where are the holes that are leaking of corruption? How is corruption being conducted in this government?
It is in procurement. It is in deals. That's the biggest place where corruption is done in Kenya. One day I asked somebody who came to my office, a business lady who came to my office, and I asked, Madam, just be honest, Do you think the government is paying fair price? And he actually smiled at me and said, sir, to be honest, no. The government is paying like 5-10 times the real market price. Now, you cannot legislate against values or morality. And that's where we have a problem. We have a problem because everybody says you have to have this law, you have to have this law. You can even use the law to still cut deals. Because the officers, I mean, the technical people, the one who do evaluation, it is technical people. So if you tell them, I want this one to win, and they tell that other person, you do A, B, C, D, and then your bid becomes the highest. So you really have got to just call people to order.
Okay, fine. In which sectors do you think corruption is biggest in this country?
No, I don't think you can say that. I think all sectors are the same. Public sector in as a whole, and part of the reason why the public sector is susceptible to corruption is because of the big bureaucracy. It's a big organ, a big thing, and people, there's almost a bureaucratic system with a lot of confusion in it. You really have to completely turn it around. You have to overhaul it, make it simple, make it more flatter, so that, for example, right now, most ministries of government, there's only one decision maker. It's called the permanent secretary. You find very clever people like David McCarley coming there, and you are a director. You have no powers. Everybody stops, is paralyzed. It's always the secretary, you know, PS has to decide. PS, even from one selection, PS.
Actually, there are lots of people texting and complaining about your time as PS of education, saying that you disenfranchised their children and, you know, therefore cut short their academic prospects.
That's not fair. Mm-hmm. That is the middle class speaking. What I did is that I actually empowered most children rather than the other way around.
At the expense of some?
No. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you this. Mm-hmm. Let me just give you statistics. Mm-hmm. Because statistics speak. In 2011 admission, the number of children who went to private schools were, you know, constituted 17% of the candidature, okay, of KCPE candidature. But they took almost 40% of places in national schools and top county schools or provincial schools. So 17% taking 40%. So the rest of the kids took 60%. Just begin there. How did I marginalize them? But what they mean is that prior to that, almost you allowed marks and nothing else to determine who went to which school. But then you're saying a child who is in Gorogosho has the same chance as a child who is in another primary school in Lavington, and that's not fair already. The system already is not fair. If that's the argument they want, then they should have said we should have set an exam based on the conditions of where the child is. But it is one exam, and you have a child who is studying under a tree, and one who is going to a school that's not even a school, and another one going to a modern school. So what we tried to do was to do use merit, that's why they took 40% because of merit, even though they were only 17%. We also used what we call district quarters. We have done that since, and then we also tried to pick bright kids from public schools to have also a chance at these national schools. In any case, they are called national schools because they were supposed to promote integration and then inclusion, bring children from all over. So that policy, I will stand on it even today, even if at the risk of not getting your vote, I will still do it because it was the most rational and the most equitable way of bringing our country together.
David, why do you think that's funny?
Yeah, no. I actually agree with Prof on that one. I think he brought equity or equalization within the education
system. He leveled
the
playing field.
Leveling the education. So I think I would commend him if he was the one responsible for that policy.
It was me.
Okay, congrats.
So give me marks. Thank you.
On that, you have under half of my vote. But now let's go to the higher education.
Yes.
Where there is really, in my view, chaos.
I agree.
With the parallel education system, universities around every corner on every building, really, what's going on? And you have been a dean of the faculty, is it a forestry? You've been in the university teaching before these things happened. The education became this liberal, so to speak. What is the cure for the
education
that we're having, which is chaotic?
By the way, Fox, the biggest challenge in our education system right now is university education, because it has become commercialized. Yeah. There's a problem between the so-called regular and parallel. And there are universities popping up in every corner of every town in Kenya. What I would do, honestly, I would do three things that are very important. Number one, I will harmonize the loan system and put more money and make it, restructure it so that you can actually get back the money from the people who have finished, but also make sure that every child or every person who is qualified, whether they are from a rich family or a poor family, can access the loans. And the loan system, even in more than the other universities in the world, there are parents who will say, I will not even want my child to take a loan because I can afford to pay.
Right.
You must structure it and make it possible for you, if you can afford, not to go and take the loan. But also make it possible for a parent who is extremely poor or not able to pay, for that child to get 100% loan. You know, people talk of getting 100% loan, 10% loan, but not saying that the maximum you get is 40% no matter what. So even if you get 40% and the real cost is 100,000,
yes,
where will you still get 60?
Yeah.
So structure that. Number two, I would like to consolidate the colleges and the campuses we have. Instead of them going to open more and more and more, build the ones that we have to international standards, so that if it is more university in Eldoret, they have almost 3,000 acres of land. Instead of them opening campuses all over the world, why don't they first of all even make better use of that land and create an international university where kids from Africa and other parts of the world can come? So it is consolidation and rationalization of programs, because of this commercial element, people are duplicating. There's a lot of duplication and overlaps, and people teaching almost the same thing, and quality has gone down. And then thirdly,
so what would you do?
No, that's what I'm doing. Consolidate, consolidate, and stop.
Stop
creating
or
more.
Close them.
Not close. Build the ones that you have, you know, to full capacity. Don't leave half capacity and keep opening. Consolidation means that instead of having 20 campuses, you can have 15 campuses but expand them until you make full use of the capacity. Rationalize the programs as well. And then thirdly, put more money into research. Make them attractive. That's why when they do this international competition, we don't do very well because we are measured on the basis of research output. And Kenya's economy will be driven by technology and innovation, and that's research.
Have you put a cost to all of these plans that you're working on for Kenya?
I told you my plan is based on Vision 2030. It is doing what we are doing already better. I don't want to tell people.
So you've not costed it. You don't think we need 2 billion shillings to.
I have approximation.
Right.
I've just told you, for example, if I wanted to reform the hospitals and build facilities, if I put every county at 1 billion, I will take one hospital and I will upgrade it, and it will be like Kenyatta or better, but at the county level. Let me give you another example. We can ensure 100% transition. Right now, 120,000 kids are missing from one. What do we need to make sure nobody misses from one? If you put 3 billion and you build, for example, classrooms in 3,000, let's say, day schools all over Kenya, just build another classroom there at a cost of 1 million shillings, that is 3 billion, you can absorb all the children. If you put another 3 billion, you build the laboratories. So those are the kind of practical things I want to do.
All right, thank you very much. We'll have to pause for a minute to remind you that you're watching Cheche, the program where opinion counts, live on Citizen TV, with our guest presidential candidate, Professor James Ole Kiyiapi.